Welcome back to the single sign-on server and client installation tutorial. We left off at the completion of the installation of the single sign-on server. Let's go ahead and get this configured. Let's just get it started. First off, we hit the configuration page. We need to make sure our time zone is correct, that our system clock looks correct, that our clock drift is the way we want it, which dictates how long the absolute minimum our session length is for logins, as well as other miscellaneous options. I like to personally throw in a little message that says, you know, if you believe this to be an error, contact dot dot dot, which will show up if someone gets banned as a spammer. It is possible for that to happen, and it's nice to have a little friendly message that lets them know that they've been banned for a specific reason. Block details provides more information on why the block happened. Now, you don't have to. I just like to do it. It's nice. The next step is to set up a nice blacklist. The documentation has this lovely little block of text where you can copy and paste it. I'm going to comment this out because I don't have a password for this particular DNS RBL. But basically this says, hey, is this IP address banned? And the response will come back as yes or no. And are they a spammer? Yes or no. And that's very useful to have to keep spammers out. The next spot is the ability to blacklist based on geolocation. If you download and install a geolocation database that maps IP address to the location in the world, you can get city and state and country and all that information. And you can blacklist on that, and or you can map to other fields, which I'll get to fields and field mapping in a bit. You can map the person's city into their user account information. A little creepy, but it's certainly possible and doable. I'm going to go ahead and save this and move on to the next section, which is managing fields. What is a field? All right, a field is something like first name, and I get the option to encrypt the field or not. I'm not gonna do it for first name, but sure, I'll go ahead and plug in a couple more fields, and I'll set a couple of them to actually, yeah, why not? Let's encrypt that field. All right, then we'll do email address, don't encrypt that. And then we'll do username. And we'll go ahead and encrypt that. All right, now I've got four fields, and all these fields constitutes what a user account is made up of. So I've got email, first name, last name, username. That's what a user account is in this system. The next step is to set up a provider. The single sign-on server comes with a whole bunch of different providers. I'm going to install the generic login provider. In order to install it, I have to make a decision up front, and this is very difficult to change later on, if not downright impossible. So choose wisely. I happen to like email address and username, but whatever your needs are, yeah, select that. I'm going to go ahead and use this default and install it. And now I've got generic login installed. Now I'm ready to configure it. The first thing I have to do is map username, because generic login doesn't know what fields are in the database. It doesn't understand what a field is. It's just a string. I have to manually say, map your username to this field in the user account when somebody signs in. Username is mapped to username. And then I can blacklist, and there's tons of options. I'm going to do the same thing for email address. Email address is a little bit difficult to set up because I got to say something like verify your account. And then somewhere around here in the documentation is a little blob of text I can copy and paste. Plug in whatever information I want there. Do the same thing for recover your account. Copy and paste this blob of text. Again, refining it however I want later on. Tons of options. Maybe I want two-factor authentication. Require every user to have two-factor authentication enabled. The defaults are usually really good balance between security and user-friendliness. Lots of options here. Maybe I want somebody to sign a terms of service and make sure they check a checkbox, say, yes, I agree to this legal agreement when creating an account. So I could enable that and hit save. And now this gets an asterisk. And now I can plug in information in here. URL, the terms of service, or just the documents text. Same for privacy policy. Again, lots of options. ReCAPTCHA, rate limiting. I really like the rate limiting module. It prevents people from registering 500 accounts in one day, because that's obviously a spammer tactic. It keeps people honest and not abusing the system. So I really like the rate limiting module. Defaults are actually pretty good. That is the generic login provider. One last thing I have to do is, before I can install the single sign-on client, is I have to set up an API key. So I'm gonna go and add an API key to the system. First, I gotta enter in a namespace. It could be anything, really. Basically, a namespace is this. I have web application 1 and web application 2. Each one has its own single sign-on client. Each one of those has its own API key. And each API key has its own namespace. So let's say a user signs in to web application 1. They're signing to web application 1, and then somehow they get over to web application 2. Well, they're not signed into that, so the system sends them to sign in. But the single sign-on server sees that they are already signed into web application 1, the namespaces are identical, and it kicks them back and says, you're already signed in. You're now signed in automatically into web application 2. Very, very cool, very nice. I like two different namespaces. I like the blank namespace. I also like admin as a namespace. So admin tools get their own namespace, and I have to sign in with potentially different usernames and passwords. Purpose is just a text string, you know, my new web app. Whatever the purpose of the API key is, live URL, again, optional. Then some other options. I'm just gonna go ahead and click create. Boom. Now I got my wonderful new API key. And the last thing I have to do is I have to map fields. So I mapped fields from the generic login provider to the SSO server. Now I have to map fields from the SSO server to the SSO client. So the SSO client can retrieve information about the user account. Now let's say I don't want last name. I don't want the client to have last name for whatever reason. Maybe it doesn't need it. Maybe I don't want it to have it. Whatever the reason is, I can leave it blank and the server will not allow access to that. But I'm just going to go ahead and have all of these, and I can change the name. I can change it from last underscore name to just last name with no underscore between the words. I'm going to go ahead and save this, and now my API key is ready. We are now ready to install the single sign-on client, which will be in the next video.